Everybody, we have special guest today, Peter Kelamis, and I hope I pronounced that right.
Yep, Peter Kelamis, I've heard, I accept all of the pronunciations.
Well, that's lucky for me because I am terrible with pronunciation.
Well, I'm throwing the Greek name at you, so, you know, it can go squirrely.
All right, that works out perfectly.
Yeah.
So anyway, I guess the biggest question for me is, what was it like to voice Goku? How did you get into voicing Goku?
It was probably one of the toughest. Oh, I'll do the beginning first of how I got it. Like anything else, it was an audition that fell into my agent's lap and then was passed down to me. And at the time, Ian Corlett was doing the voice of Goku, who's a buddy of mine. And we have a similar cadence. I might be a little bit deeper than him at times, but a similar cadence. So we would often go out for the same auditions, the same roles. So when this came up, I think the casting community in Vancouver kind of looked at me and said, oh, you know, these guys can go up against each other quite a bit. So let's get Peter in to read for it. I read for it and got it. It was, I guess, as simple as that. It's an audition. It didn't seem like anything special at the time. You know, obviously it is because I'm here talking to fine folks like yourself over 20 years later and going to conventions and stuff. So it obviously meant a lot to a lot of people, and it meant a lot to me too. But at the time, we didn't really know what we were getting into. Brian Drummond's mentioned that before when he was cast as Vegeta as well. We didn't really know what was going on. It's like, oh, it's a role, and we dive into the role and do the best we can. And it was a difficult one to do vocally because there's obviously so much screaming and so much fighting, especially with the scripts at the time. I think a little more has changed now, but at the time, I mean, they'd be fighting for weeks. I'm not even kidding. We would finish one episode of, and then they join a week later. Okay, and let's pick it up where we left off. And just they'd be screaming for 3 weeks. So initially, we would go through the script, naturally from page to page. And then they realized our voices would be blown out by, you know, page five or six. So they changed how they recorded, and we would do all our dialogue first for the whole script and then go back for all the screaming, because your voice would be just shot for a couple of days.
I can remember my actual first introduction to your version of Goku.
Right.
For Christmas, my brother had bought me a VHS copy of The World's Strongest. And yep. This was when Toonami was running. It was a mixture of the original Ocean dub, and then they would run the Funimation takeover. Right. And when I put the DVD in, or VHS, sorry, mm-hmm. in, I was kind of just blown away with it. For one, it had cussing in it, and I was like, they never cuss in the show. My little 10-year-old brain was like, whoa.
Oh, yeah. There was all sorts of stuff. Like, you know, there was bare asses here and there, and just, they'd be drinking beer, and just it was all over the place. But it culturally, Japanese culture wasn't as sensitive to those kinds of things as North America was at the time. And that's just what it was.
I mean, I still have, you've seen my collection. I've tagged you on Twitter multiple times with my,
yes.
Cool. I still watch those old box sets once in a while because it's like, well, that's part of my childhood. Yeah, they redid it and they uncut it and stuff, but right. That original first 53 episodes.
Yeah.
That was and I'm thinking that's many 90s kids childhood.
I hear that a lot at conventions where that phrase exactly is, thanks for being a part of my childhood or making my childhood or the comments, wonderful comments like that. Obviously, as an actor, you'd be a fool to take credit for it because you're an actor being paid to do a role. And although you try to do your best, it's still always, you know, an honor and a privilege to hear comments like that and compliments like that, especially in person at conventions. Every one of them means a lot. And it means a lot to a lot of people. So it's feels good.
Honestly, I think one of my favorite voices that you do for Goku is in The World's Strongest, when he does that gut-wrenching scream, Kaioken, that blew my mind. I was like, whoa. And then I listened to the Japanese version when I got older, and I'm like, it's like he emulated that original Japanese voice actress's voice. It's amazing.
Well, we did. We were working off of her dub. So they would play, you know, her performance, which continues to be amazing to this day, into her 80s. She's an amazing individual. I call her the Beyonce of animation, because it's a queen-like status, and it's well-earned. But yeah, they would play, we were dubbing, so they would play, that's the version we had to dub off of, was the Japanese, and our biggest challenge was trying to match the voice flaps to the dialogue, and oftentimes that didn't work, so we had to, you know, improvise on the fly with the director and try to make it happen.
Do you remember that particular scene doing the Kaioken?
I do. Like I actually do.
Did it actually hurt your voice, or?
Yeah. Yeah, it did. I mean, I you want to do the, as an actor, you want to do the best performance that you can. And in voice acting, probably more so than live action, you tend to push yourself sometimes, and you don't realize till after you've hurt yourself that you hurt yourself. So you scream loud and proud and with authority, and you hope you can talk the next day.
Well, those three movies, especially the ones that you guys did first, right. I mean, they were the closest that DBZ ever got to being following the original Japanese script. And I even noticed the voices even matched up with the Japanese. They sound nearly just like the original actors from Japan. You know, those are my three favorite movies. I've studied them a lot, if you can't tell.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. I appreciate it.
Even when I did my retrospective of the Ocean dub on my channel not too long ago, mm-hmm. I was like, well, this is the closest we've ever gotten to DBZ having a really close dub to the Japanese track. Because I remember when Funimation took over, they liked to ad lib and add lines where characters weren't talking, and that would just drive me nuts.
Well, again, not a criticism to them or trying to explain how they did their thing, but obviously we were dubbing directly from the Japanese, and primarily they, when that cast took over, they were studying us, the North American cast, which they've said, I mean, I'm not guessing at that's who they studied when they were auditioning and landing their roles for the series moving forward.
Also, this will probably be a fun question to answer. Who's tougher to voice, Rolf or Goku?
Oh, Goku. Just like I say, from the pure strain. I mean, Rolf was hard to voice because we would crack up so much. Like I was gifted with the best lines of the show from the script perspective. And it was the funnest character I've ever gotten to do. And I've said this in interviews before. Initially, we all used to record together, all the Eds and the neighborhood kids in one room. And we would have a blast because we would be laughing our asses off constantly. And eventually, no, it didn't take that long. They divided us up. They said, no more, because it's taking too long. You guys are having too much fun. So we're going to record the Eds in one section and the rest of the neighborhood kids in another. I think it was Erin Fitzgerald's fault, because she would crack up so bad, and she has this very loud cackle, this wonderful cackle. I think she enjoyed it more than I did, which is saying a lot, because I love that role.
I mean, I love it too. I mean, Rolf is my favorite character out of Ed, Edd, and Eddy, and I didn't realize till 20 years later that Rolf was Goku this whole time. So my mind was blown when I became an adult. I was like, whoa, no way.
I still see people on the internet, Twitter, Instagram, what have you, where they post that after discovering it for the first time. And they still, even at conventions, like I have both things on my banner behind me, and they're just like, well, you didn't do that. Like I've had people say, so you were the animator for Ed, like Rolf? And I go, no, I did the voice, and I'll throw out the hello, it boy. And then they, you know, they lose their minds in disbelief. So
do you have an actual favorite Rolf moment throughout the series? I'm sure there's tons, but do you have one
there
particular
is, there
moment?
There is tons. There's times where I just kind of late at night troll the internet and go, like, you know, Rolf quotes, because we did it so long ago and it was done so haphazardly, in the sense of we would record a block of episodes and then not record for months and that type of thing. So I have forgotten a lot of the quotes, because I mean, we did the show, it was a span of 10 years. So you forget sometimes a line you did so long ago, and they still make me laugh when I read them. But the most stressful moment was, it was the Christmas special. And I remember we went in and without notice, they said, oh, you're going to sing the Yechmayek song, which was this legendary individual who would haunt kids at Christmas, you know, essentially.
Kind of like the Krampus.
Yeah, exactly. It was Krampus. A Rolfian Krampus.
I remember that song.
Oh, God. But they gave me no warning. They gave me no warning to a song that went so quickly and was I'm not a singer to begin with. I can mock other singers as an imitator, being a stand-up, but I'm not a singer. So they hand me this thing, and I have literally like 10 or 15 minutes ago, at the end, we're going to record you doing the song. And I'm like, what the hell are you talking about? Like, I got no heads up on this. And they're like, oh, no. It's like, oh, okay. So I said in my mind, I go, either we're going to do this in like one or two takes, or we're going to be here for hours, because that song like moves, you know, it's like, oh, yes, that pace is just, it's insane. And then we got two takes.
And I've also heard Danny Antonucci is a perfectionist. So
absolutely. So that's why it's even more of a miracle that in two takes, he went perfect. Great. With Danny, either it's perfect or let's do take number 49. There's no in between. It's not like that's good enough. It's perfect, or you're going to stay there until it's perfect. So,
because Matt had told me stories. He said he spent 3 hours in the recording booth trying to do Ed's voice. And he said Danny didn't like a certain way that he did it. Mm-hmm. And he made him do it about 300 times over. He said by the time he was done, his voice was so hoarse he couldn't talk.
No, and when you do a line that many times, especially something that is so simple, but in the director or creator's mind, it's not landing the right way. It could be as simple as, whatever the line may be, it's like, hey, Eddie! And it's like, well, no, you're saying, hey, Eddie, when I want, hey, Eddie. And you're like, I don't hear the difference, but okay, let's do it. I remember when we had those group records, sometimes the Eds, those poor bastards. I remember, like, Matt sometimes, it 30 takes, sometimes more, for a very simple line. And we're all pulling our hair out going, the hell does he want? But, and I know Danny, I'm not taking the piss out of Danny in a angry way, because let's face it, we're still talking about the show decades later and it holds up. I mean, I've watched episodes that in, and they hold up, and there's something special there. And, proud to have made it happen or been a part of it, you know?
I think what people love about it is it resonates with childhood. And honestly,
yes.
It, that's why it holds up so good today, because as a kid, you watch it and you think, yeah, I'm doing this now. And as an adult, you think, well, this is pretty much me when I was a kid. And you know these kids, or you are these kids. That's why the show is so good.
And I'm, you know, I'm obviously older than you are, but I come from a generation where our parents, especially in the summertime or on a weekend, would open up the door, front door, at like 9 a.m. and off you went. Off you went as a kid. And then they would open the door at 5 to 6, scream your name out in the neighborhood saying dinner. And then you'd show up, you'd eat, and then you'd run out for another couple hours. And that was life. But that was much like the cul-de-sac where you went out with your friends on your bikes and whatever. Went to the corner store and bought candy, whatever you did. It was this neighborhood adventure. And I think that show captured that feeling. Like there was an innocence about it where there was never anything legitimately menacing about Ed and Eddy. It was comically menacing at times, you know, for various reasons, storylines. But everybody was safe. And it was just this adventure in the neighborhood. And it was just really cool.
Well, they were safe unless they threw Rolf's food against the fence. And, yeah. And Eddy gets beaten with a dead fish.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that kind of stuff, which is fine.
That scene to this day, I don't know if you've seen it, but I did a video editing where Goku is fighting Frieza. And I edit Rolf. And I put Rolf on there and he says,
yeah.
If it's true, have you brought the cupcakes of sorriness?
And Frieza's cupcakes like, of sorriness? Yes.
And Frieza's like, no. And then it just has him just slapping the crap out of Frieza.
It's just a bitch slapping after that. Yeah.
I mean, it's just a fantastic show. And that in Dragon Ball Z, that was just huge parts of my childhood, especially The Dead Zone, The World's Strongest, and The Tree of Might. Those movies, like if I were to put any of them out there, I would put them all together and just say they're the best. If you want to see a good dub to DBZ, watch the Ocean Dub version of those films, and you'll see why so many people love the Ocean Dub so much.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Because the way you capture Goku to me, it just, I mean, I'm not saying I dislike Sean or Ian's performance or anyone's performance. I like everyone's, but I think the way you captured him makes him sound authentic. If that's a better way to word it.
No, I appreciate it. And Ian Corlett's talked about this too. I mean, people say, who's your favorite Goku? I still see polls that people put up saying, you know, vote for your favorite Goku. And it's a weird thing to ask. I think when it's that far generationally removed, because you have fans of the show now that only know the current voice actor doing it. And then you have people that grew up with either myself or Ian or Kirby doing it. And it's kind of like, you know, Ian said it, he goes, it's kind of like saying, who's your favorite James Bond or your favorite Superman or Batman or Spider-Man. And I can go down the list, or numerous actors have played the role. And a lot of times it comes down to who's the one that you grew up with, which is the one that usually people make the strongest connection with. So, you know, it's cool that you enjoy those earlier performances. I think I get a lot of people who used to watch it with their parents when they were younger. And I get that kind of generational range in the people that seem to have enjoyed what I did.
Well, I've got to say, I mean, it, like I said, the movies are, and the Ocean Dub in general, is just a legacy. I mean, it's a shame that the DVDs are now out of print and they don't make them anymore.
Yeah, they're very hard to find.
I'm lucky I bought these when I was a teenager, seeing them at Walmart in the box set. I said, I got to have
them. Yeah. I have a couple of action figures from... At the time, I just bought, you know, same thing. I was in a discount store somewhere, like it was a Walmart or Target, I can't remember. But I go, Goku. And I still have them in the packaging. But I look back now and they're like, you know, they're 25 years old almost now. And I'm like, oh, okay. They're probably worth something. But I just bought them because, hey, I do that voice. And that's a cool thing about being a voice actor. Sometimes you run into like a Walmart kind of thing. You're like, oh, there's me. I'm going to buy that just because it's a... That's a neat memento for the office.
I think it's almost criminal that the full Ed, Edd n Eddy series has not been put on DVD yet. Only the first two seasons.
Exactly. Exactly. And you know what? I would love, and I don't know where to petition this. I actually wrote them an email once. I never heard back. Is where are the Funko Pops for Ed, Edd n Eddy? Like, please.
Yeah, we need one of Rolf.
Well, just all of the characters. You know, Plank, he should have his own... pop figure. It's just a hunk of wood, as he is. But
say what you want about Plank, I think that character's real, because
it's
that
fantastic
thing, that thing moved and stuff when Johnny wasn't even anywhere near the thing.
Right. I know he was the 90s version of a shelf or a elf on a shelf, really, where it's just carried him around the neighborhood.
Do you remember doing the movie? And you probably do, because I did post a picture of it. I'll Be Home for Christmas, the bus driver.
Oh, yeah.
What was it like working on that one? I mean, did they just bring you in and you had to read your lines? Or
No, I had to audition. And I believe, if I'm memory serves me, I think, believe Nell Scoville was the director, I believe. And she was very, very nice to work with. And Jonathan Taylor, right, was the lead of the show.
Yeah, JTT is what the 90s called.
Yes, Jonathan Taylor and Jessica Biel was the female lead on the show. And she, at the time, I think she was like 16 years old or something. And she had just moved to LA from Colorado. And we were talking about, you know, she just kind of hit LA and was hitting her stride with things. And they were both extremely wonderful and nice to work with, especially Jonathan, because he had the Home Improvement fame. I mean, he was a child star at the time. But he was extremely down to earth and very, very nice. I've had very, very few bad encounters with celebrities or fellow actors on stage or on film. There's been a couple, but it's pretty rare.
I just remember that character stood out a lot, and I was watching it with the family at one point, and when he was yelling, "I care about that little girl," I just flat out said, "That's Goku's voice."
Yeah. And I should have picked up the mic. Everybody behind the yellow line, yes? You know, I think that would have gotten behind the line. Yeah.
I think that movie was just a little before Ed, Edd n Eddy, though. I'm not sure, but I think it was 98. I think Ed, Edd n Eddy came out 99.
Yeah, I think it was right around that time. You're right. I'd have to double check.
And then how did you like working on, I think it was Stargate?
Wonderful. Wonderful. The story on that was I had auditioned for SG-1 numerous times, to the point where I told my agent, don't send me, if an audition comes for Stargate, don't even send me. I don't get them. They hate me. I don't know what I'm doing wrong. You know, and I was a fairly busy actor at the time, but for some reason, I just could not land a role on the show. And then they go, well, one more came, another audition, just go try it. And it was Peter DeLuise was directing, who I've since worked with many times. And, you know, would consider a friend of mine. He's a great, great guy and very, very talented in aspects of everything, acting, directing, you go down the list. He was directing and I got the part and then went in and did it. And then I got another part on the show under extreme prosthetics the following year, because usually they don't want to reuse actors that quickly. When they're in a city filming, lots of times you'll see the same actor showing up in different seasons in different roles. But luckily this was a heavy prosthetic thing, so I got to do the show a second time.
I remember watching that show a lot with my grandfather. He's a big space nut. I mean,
yeah.
He's had us watch Star Trek, Star Wars, Enterprise, you name it.
Right.
We've had to watch it. And I do remember you in the show particularly. I think you were actually his favorite character.
Oh, well, thank you. I mean, and after I did the SG-1s, I ended up landing the role in Stargate Universe, which was a wonderful, I mean, the topic matter was kind of heavy, much more so than the previous Stargates. So that kind of threw fans, I think, initially. I think people look back on it much more fondly than they did at the time, because at the time, the producers even admit in the same breath, they said, we're canceling Atlantis, we're giving you SGU. And fans were stunned and angry, and there was a lot of backlash against our show initially. And at the time, it was kind of the explosion of downloading. I mean, it sounds like it was a million years ago, but at the time, you had to wait to watch a show. And that was kind of the beginning of people downloading the show on their systems, computers, phones, whatever. And that affected ratings dramatically. And I think the studio would look at those ratings and just go, ratings on the show are way fewer than the previous Stargates. And I think that affected their perception. Also, a lot of people don't know, all the other Stargates ran in the summertime in non-prime time television. So in it was in the off season. So the ratings are pretty good. We went up against the number one show, I think, on TV at the time in prime time, and we were a cable show. So we had a lot against us. And I think had we had some of those factors change, I think it would have had a much longer run.
Well, I have really good memories of it. I'm not sure, but I don't think it has a physical release either, does it?
Stargate Universe? Yes, it does.
Yeah, I was talking about the SG-1, too.
No. I think they're primarily in box sets, but they are available, yeah.
But like I said, now I do have another question, and I'm going back to DBZ again just because it's fun. How long did you voice Goku until the late, great Kirby Morrow came in?
Now, this gets difficult to answer because they went away and came back a number of times. Brian Drummond said this too. Like, we would record and then they said, okay, that's it. They're gone. Oh, okay. And then they would come back for another session of records. And we're like, we thought they left. And even our agents were confused. And I know there's like a Kai dub out there floating around, this mythical dub of the show. I can't give you a definitive answer of like any other regular show where I say, oh, we finished filming in June of 2004 or something. I actually don't know because the last we heard was, oh, the show packed up, moved to Dallas, and they're recasting with a cast down there. And we're like, okay, well, I guess that's the end. And then, then they came back after that. But they had moved on.
I know, because I remember seeing snippets on TV of like the Cell Saga and the Android Saga. And I was like, wait a minute. They never got that far. It never aired over here like that. But I had friends in the UK tell me, no, they UK. Did. They aired over here.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember being at a convention in the UK, and in the background, they had a documentary. I don't know where, I wish I could get my hands on the documentary. I should contact them. But they had the history of DBZ, and it was very, very detailed, describing what you were just talking about, was what dubs were released in the UK versus North America and Japan, and when they happened and who voiced them. And I got to get my hands on that thing because it was really interesting.
Do you have a favorite Goku line that you like the most?
I get asked that a lot. And for whatever reason, my favorite one was that tub of lard was a good warm up.
That's from my favorite movie, too.
Right. So for whatever reason, that one resonates with me and people ask. And I go, yeah, that's the line that makes me chuckle the most.
I would have to say, which I think I've already said, it is the Kaioken scene from the same movie. I mean,
yeah,
I don't know how you did it. That was just epic how you just were able to scream that. It sounded like your vocal cords went through serious pain.
There was some strain on that, I'm not gonna lie. But I've looked back at it too and just going, yeah, it's pretty good. It's pretty pretty happy, like, with that one.
How did I do that? Which, honestly, and I'm gonna be honest about it, I have a little history with that. There was a DVD set, and this is before I found this one at Walmart, of the first three movies in a box set. I got them. I said, I've only got the VHSs, so I'm going to try these DVDs out. I put them in, and it was Funimation's version, and I was just completely just, I was like, this movie stinks. It's like, all the dialogue's changed up. I don't like it.
It's disappointing when anything you pop in, you know, like in that regard has changed, because you have an expectation of what you're wanting to hear. And then a lot of times like that, they change it and they're a little unclear as to what you're getting.
I personally think with at least the first three movies, they should put that track on there as an option, so people could
be able to watch
either version of it that they want.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think they should do that with their current releases of DBZ DVDs. It's like, well, if you guys ever did an uncut version, maybe not, they should put like that as an option, because so many people grew up with those tracks. And
yeah,
like me, you know, I'm just a big dumb kid that lives in nostalgia.
No, I mean, there's a lot of people that enjoy nostalgia. I mean, I know I do. And when you've grown up with something, you want, especially in this day and age, I mean, with, you know, animation and just companies in general wanting to sell, it seems like an obvious thing to me that we'll release the previous ones. Why would you not? I there's a large audience for it, and you've already got the tapes, and just hit print and send them out. But those are decisions I don't make.
It was kind of like, it's kind of like if you get Ed, Edd, and Eddy, and then they just changed all the voice actors just to say, well, this is a more current version. It's more PC and stuff. It's like, it doesn't matter. Yeah. We want our stuff. Don't change stuff.
I know. I totally get it.
It's like the Star Wars remastered Greedo shooting first to make things better. Right. It's like, no, come on.
Yeah,
these
no.
people worked on the set. They did just as much hard work as the, you know, Funimation dub when they took over.
Right.
They deserve to have their voices heard too, not to be just blacklisted and put on the side. Like, well, if you want to just go buy that version.
Yeah. I get it. You're a purist. And I totally get it.
I'm a nerd, so yeah.
I mean, as am I. I remember growing up being loving, you know, animation, cartoons, all of that stuff. I delved into comic books, but I never really had access to a ton of them. So I would buy them when I could. But I didn't have a big collection of them. But I was fascinated by just, I mean, I remember at the time, again, I'm aging myself, but when I grew up, you watched cartoons Saturday morning. That's it. That's when they were on. You didn't just turn it on when you wanted to. You woke up early on Saturday, planted your ass in front of the TV, and you sat there for hours. You know, that's what you did. I mean, I remember, I think when, the Cartoon Network first opened up, and I was like, what? Like a channel with cartoons 24 hours a day? Like, that's insane. How could they do this? And now there's multiple
streaming.
You know, it's a new day. I keep aging myself when I hear myself say it, but it's like the accessibility to everything nowadays is just incredible.
Well, see, I'm a physical media kind of guy. I have to own everything that I like on DVD or Blu-ray or whatever.
Yeah.
Because I say, well, what if the internet goes out? What if it just, you know,
backfires
and breaks? You can't watch your stuff no more. That's why things that are so buried deep, you know, they deserve to be brought back out and, you know, have relevancy again.
Right.
And that's how I feel with the three Ocean Dub movies. At least give those extras on the track. You know, you don't even have to announce that they're extras on the track. They did it with Akira. They put the original 1989 dub on there.
Right.
I don't understand why they couldn't put the original 90s dub on the three original movies.
I don't know. I would love it to, you know, get my hands on it too. I mean, I know that Rock the Dragon set had come out a while back, but trying to find that now, you can find it, but it's going to cost you a lot of money. Well, in an eBay situation where they're still quite expensive.
I had the Rock the Dragon set, but you know, that was back when I was just buying to buy. And I only paid 50 for it. I sold it. And the only reason I sold it was because I needed the money at the time. And I already had the two Saiyan Saga and Namek Saga releases out. I was like, well, this one's just taking up a lot of space.
Yeah.
It's so big.
Right.
But I still had the Ocean Dub.
Right.
Like you said, I'm a purist. So, and DBZ, it's played a huge part in my life. If you can't tell, I'm the biggest dork for it.
Well, yeah, but I mean, I don't know. When you go to conventions, you meet, that's the best thing about conventions, because people, if they have felt isolated or, you know, are socially awkward or whatever, they get to go there and meet like-minded people and realize that they're not weird. They're not alone. Other people have these same interests, and there's nothing wrong with you. And that's the coolest thing I see at conventions, is some people who are really socially awkward kind of coming out of their shell and doing a cosplay or just doing whatever. It's just a wonderful place to go and kind of enjoy what you enjoy with other people.
And honestly, that's the way it should be too. And
yeah.
Hopefully they strike down COVID and we could start going back to that again and getting out again.
It is. The conventions are starting to roll out again. I just actually just finalizing one literally this morning. So I'm going to be heading to, I can't even say, I'm heading somewhere warm in the States. That's no clue, in June. But I've got, if you count that one, I'll have three announcements for conventions coming out very, very soon, which I'm excited about. And it's only January, so I hope it gets busier and busier in regards to that, because I really enjoy them.
Anyway, I do want to say thank you so much for agreeing to do an interview and coming on. I really appreciate it.
Well, thank you. It was a pleasure talking to you. And, you know, it was like we were sitting there having a beer, just chatting DBZ.
Oh, yeah. So. It's like having a conversation with just one of the biggest dorks in the world. That's me. If you look through my YouTube channel, you'll see it's like DBZ, DBZ, DBZ. Oh, there's one show that's different. DBZ, DBZ.
And that's awesome. And that's awesome.
But, you know, I think what makes people, you know, so different is their passions and their interest. And honestly, passionate about DBZ, and I always have been. I probably always will be.
And that's awesome.
Anyway, is there anything you want to say before we close out?
No, I mean, other than, you know, like I say, I hope conventions continue to kind of open up and things get better and better in regards to people having access to interact a lot more. It looks like that is on the horizon. And we're all keeping our fingers crossed, but I look forward to, you know, seeing people at conventions, meeting people at conventions, and hope that everybody continues to enjoy what they're into.